Hello. It is Monday, November 23rd, 3 o'clock a.m. here in U.S. Eastern Standard Time, and I am live. YouTube is saying that I have an excellent connection, which is good, because I've been in the mood to stream lately, and my internet has gone through phases where it was less cooperative than it should be. So I'm hoping that it continues to cooperate. This is Super Win the Game. This is an exploration platformer that came out in 2014, I think, originally. This is the sequel to You Have to Win the Game, which is another game that I streamed previously, way back in 2015. So, this game was already out when I streamed You Have to Win the Game. But that one's free, and this one I did not own yet at the time. Which is a shame, because it's really good. And the developer of this game recently added a randomized mode that I've been having a lot of fun with. I think the randomized patch came out in May of this year, and I learned about it a couple months ago. And I've always been interested in game randomizers. I've watched quite a few streams, but there hasn't been a game that I've really known well enough that I felt comfortable playing it in that way. Like, I'm not, like, super familiar with, like, Link to the Past or Super Metroid or anything like that. This game, it's still, you know, large-ish, but it has more of a limited scope, and I think this is a really good game to learn for, like, your first randomizer. I think that it's a nice, comfortable experience, and I'm hoping I can complete a seed here on stream. I've completed a few just playing on my own. And there are a few that I got stuck on. And if that happens, then it happens. And that's just the way it goes sometimes. So I'm going to start a new game here, delete whatever my last game save was, and I'm going to roll a... That's not what I meant to push. Already off to a great start. Alright, I'm going to roll a new random seed here. There we go. And I will add this to my overlay here. If anyone at home wants to play along, then type in this random seed, and we will get the same game. So we have VRTM KBTD. So Vampire the Masquerade Keyboard Touchdown is one way you can remember that. Alright, let's go. So this game has a bunch of these dream sequences that are all in black and white. The first one you encounter is sort of a tutorial. Which of course I don't need, being the expert that I am. I know you all come to this stream for expert play. And I'm here to provide it. So this is the part that tutorializes you. Use keys to unlock doors. Mercifully, it only tells you that once, instead of every time you find a key. But I'm not going to unlock that door, because I'm a rebel. That's one of the few items in randomized mode that is not subject to randomization. And yeah, it gives you this little this little job, and there's an achievement for that if you play on Steam for grabbing the tutorial key but not unlocking that door. So, free extra key. So this game has some writing in it. I probably won't be talking to a lot of people, reading all the signs or anything. You know, there's plenty of 100% playthroughs of this game on YouTube and whatever. Or you can play it yourself. If you bought the itch.io bundle for racial justice, you already own this game, because this was one of the included games. So, go check it out if you are into exploration platformers at all. And, you know, the non-randomized mode is pretty good, too. Like, I replayed this game a couple times before it even had a randomized mode. But, you know, this kind of game is my jam. I'd say my top two video game genres are exploration platformers and turn-based RPGs, like console-style turn-based RPGs. And we already found the double jump boots, which that is a very good item to find early in a randomized seed, because it opens up a lot of doors, a lot of metaphorical doors. Right, can't do anything there yet. So I'm just sort of getting all of the free items, basically. Before you have to go into any dungeons or towns or anything. I usually start off by going to Lakewood Dungeon, which is the first dungeon in a vanilla run of this game. Just because, I mean, you have to start somewhere, and that's as good of a place to start as any. So yeah, of the 150-ish items in this game, 150-160-ish items, 128 of them are gems, which, you know, you only actually need about 70 or so in a normal game to finish. So, wow. So it's giving me the double jump boots and the spider gloves right off the bat. Which means this is a very nice seed. It is being very kind to me. So these are never randomized. You can always buy up to two keys from the jewelers for two gems apiece. And I only have enough to buy one for right now. And then the jeweler sells a second item. In the vanilla game, the first item you can buy that costs 30 is the skeleton key, which makes it so you don't need any other keys. And then the second item is a special ticket that opens up the gate to the underworld. And in a randomized game, usually these are both gems. So you can buy two gems for 30 gems and 20 gems, which is not a great exchange rate. And we can see, as soon as I make sure I got everything else in this town, which I'm pretty sure I did. Actually, there's someone in here that gives you an item. You can borrow a key if you have zero keys, which I have one. I've never had to borrow a key before. I guess this is only here in case you get really stuck and you just, like, this was here in the vanilla game as well, and I just never saw the need to use that feature. So this guy says he found a key, but it's actually a gem. And statistically, most of the items are going to end up actually being gems, and that's just kind of how the way the randomness works. So if we look at the map, we can see how many gems are in this town. So there are four, and I have two of them. So because I've gotten every other item in this town, these are the speedrun courses. I'm not going to bother with these. And none of these people have anything to give you, right? Yeah, you are rambling, buddy. Yeah, the speedrun courses, they're kind of interesting because they are totally separate from the rest of the game. Like, it's not just like a timer mode for the game itself. It's a totally separately designed areas, which is kind of interesting. This is the fortune teller. They give you your stats, and in the vanilla game, they give you a hand about where you need to go next, which of course isn't applicable in the randomized mode because who knows where I need to go to get what I need. So, shows you how much time you've spent, how many times you've died, how many gems you've collected. And because I absconded with the tutorial key, I'm a clever rapscallion. So yeah, seek out the Arcadian past Lakewood. Which is, you know, that's the direction I'm going to head anyway, just because I need somewhere to start, but, you know, this could be a totally fruitless endeavor. So another free item here in this little square of forest. Just a gem. Alright, go pay the Arcadian a visit. It's interesting playing this with the music on, because I almost never listen to the music while I play. Like, I don't think it's terrible or anything. Oh, well, that is the, that's the Arcadian's mark. So, since I have the double jump and the spider gloves already, I can just go ahead and grab that. Normally this is just a gem, and you would have to come back to this way later. And I have a key, so I can go on, say hello to the Arcadian. He's going to ask me to retrieve the red gem for him. Or the red orb. And he has a gem for me in return. And you can see on the map, there's a red dot there. That means this actually will be a gem, which means I don't have to bother bringing that back because I'm not going for 100%. I'm just basically, it's not a speed run. I'm just going to try to clear the seed as efficiently as possible. So this is Lakewood Dungeon. Normally this is where you would find the red orb. I expect I will find something different here, or nothing. It could just all be gems at this point, or gems and keys. You can sort of get an idea of whether an area has items by looking at the number of gems in the locality. So there are 15 gems, which that's the normal number of gems, I think. I think Lakewood Dungeon usually has 15. But if that said, you know, 14, then I would know that one of the gems was replaced with another item. And that's not a great, you know, it's not a perfect system because, you know, a gem could be replaced with a plot critical item and, like, a key could be replaced with a gem or something and it would still say 15. So this part's easier if you come back after you get the red and the blue gems, which fill in those colored boxes there. But went on ahead and grabbed it anyway, because I'm elite. Yeah, having the double jump boots and the spider gloves right from the beginning is going to make this a very easy seed, because there really aren't that many limitations to where I can go. There is a part of this dungeon that requires the Mask of the Arcadians, which is an item that lets you see certain invisible blocks, and I guess I can go ahead and show where that is. Once you get the double jump boots and the spider gloves, which, you know, normally, obviously, takes much longer than it took me this time, you can come here, and if you have the Mask of the Arcadians, then you can see the disappearing blocks that would enable you to get past that spike wall. So we will be coming back here at some point. We won't be able to do everything unless, you know, I get lucky and I find the mask in this dungeon, which is certainly possible. But yeah, playing the randomized mode, this is just a door that takes you back up here. This was a one-way door before, which you could tell because it had the no symbol on it. And that's just like the shortcut back to the surface. So I can go ahead and come down here. Normally you would come here after you get the red orb, because otherwise you couldn't make this jump. But since I have the double jump boots, I can just go ahead and get past here. I don't know what the difference between the red gems and the green gems is. Like, I thought that green gems were, it meant that it used to be a different item that turned into a gem because of the randomization, but that's not always the case, so I'm not really sure what the difference is. So this is the door back to Subcon, which this is sort of the fast travel hub in this game. Oh, no music here, huh? So this is Stimmen's Community. This was the first town on the map that I didn't go to because I knew I didn't have a reason to go here yet. But yeah, this is Lakewood right over there to the right. So Subcon gives you a faster way to move around. No coins or mushrooms to find there, unfortunately. And there's a invisible wall here. So yeah, doing the randomized mode, you really have to have 100% of the game, preferably a few times, because, you know, plot critical items are going to be hidden in super obscure areas that you would only know about if you've 100% of the game and found all the secrets. So you would be able to see this platform if I had the mask, but since I know it's here, I can just go ahead and jump onto it. You know, with the disappearing blocks, there's really no way to judge where they are without the mask, so it's kind of required for that part. And of course, you know, a lot of the, I imagine a speedrun for this game, like a glitchless speedrun, because most of the speedruns I've seen take advantage of, like, a lot of out-of-bounds glitches. But in a glitchless speedrun, I imagine you would want to know when you do and don't want to touch the checkpoints. Because depending on what checkpoints you touch, it could make it easier for you to death warp your way back to a previous part, which would be a lot faster than walking there. Do I have any keys? Yep, I have one. Might as well. So yeah, this is normally where you find the red orb, or the crimson aura. And then you can read this book, which it gives you like a short little cutscene with a dream sequence, and gives you the option to fast travel back to the entrance. And again, I'll be skipping a lot of the cutscenes and dialogue and stuff, so watch another playthrough or play the game if you want to see that stuff. See, normally you don't have the double jump boots or the spider gloves here, so you have to activate these invisible blocks to get that gem. Yeah, how fortunate for me that the first time I decide to stream this, it gives me the most advantageous early setup possible. I say as I die repeatedly. I would probably never actually speedrun any game. Any action game, certainly, because I'm just not, you know, the world's best action game player. I can't platform with 100% precision, and I don't really want to. Like, that's not a skill I'm super interested in developing or exercising, but I do think it would be fun to race this with another player of similar skill. Well, we can't go through here because we don't have the Tesla badge yet. Like, if I was playing with another player who's not, like, a speedrunner, per se, but just, you know, doing a race through it, racing someone of equal skill level to myself. Kind of like when me and Moores did the Fatal Labyrinth race. You know, we're not speedrunners. So this is another disappearing platform section that you need the mask of the Arcadians for. And I didn't realize how many parts of the game require the mask until I started doing the randomizer. Like, there's stuff that I just thought was always there. And I'm like, oh, that would have been invisible if I tried to come here before. But yeah, when me and Moores did the Fatal Labyrinth race, I thought that was pretty fun. You know, not a speedrun per se, but just trying to play effectively and efficiently. Sorry, just wanted to check real quick. Haven't streamed in a while, so I want to make sure that all of my settings are correct and the stream isn't having any issues, which it looks like it's good. Hopefully I sound good too. I did a test recording before and it sounded fine to me, but you know, you never know how different people are going to perceive the audio levels. And that's what sucks about audio, is that you're never going to find a setup that'll make 100% of people happy. You know, personally, I prefer the game audio to be pretty low in the mix, because otherwise I might have a hard time hearing the person talking. But different people feel differently about that. Okay. So that's pretty much all we can do in Lakewood Dungeon for now, but I will definitely be back here later. I guess I could have gone to the subcon door instead of walking all the way back, but it's not that long of a walk. I feel like the movement speed and everything in this game feels pretty good. Your character feels good to control. It's just a really well-designed platformer. So this is the fishing community, or the fishing village. This door, oh yeah, right, I can come here, because, so that mark on the door, hang on, let me leave and come back. That mark on the door is the, oh, it's just always open now. Anyway, that's the symbol resembles the mask of the Arcadians, so I tend to think that you need the mask to open it, but that's actually what that letter A does that I picked up, the Avengers logo. So once you get that A, you can open those doors, and there's not going to be anything I can do in here yet, because this is another you need the mask to see the platforms to get across kind of situation. And then once I get the scuba gear, I can head down there. But for now, I will leave the fishing village to its fishing. All right, so a few different possibilities of directions I can go. I think I'm going to do the ice caves next. Or the ice dungeon. Usually I do the desert second, but since I have the double jump and the spider gloves, I should be able to, like, completely clear out this area now. Some of these tunes are pretty good. Like, it's not a bad soundtrack. It just... I don't know. Four Corners Lodge. Like, the soundtrack does its job. It just doesn't really, you know, excite me or anything. This is the penguin. The penguin just kind of hangs out. But... they're an important enough character to have been featured on the box art and the title image. So, you know, secretly a very important penguin. Thanks for the key. The penguin's shy. Oh, I don't have any keys. I used my last one. Okay, so I mean, I can still do this part. I just have to hope that I find a key. Which is quite possible. This is the snowstorm. There's a secret cave here. Normally this cave holds one of the pieces of the King's Heart, which is the big plot critical key item that you need. You need six of them to unlock the final dungeon and finish the game. But this time it's just a gem. So every watery area is a place we'll have to come back to once I have the scuba gear. Slippery when always. I love that album. Hey, there's a key. Go ahead and grab that. And then here's the door leading back to Subcon. And all of these Subcon doors are, they're one way. Well, except for the underground waterway door and this one, the House of Baffle. Those two are always open. Like this one to the sky pillars. I have to actually go to the sky pillars and open that door before I can use the shortcut. Desert ruins. Here's Stimmons community. There's Lakewood Dungeon. And then down here we have the underground waterway. Or I guess they're only partially underground. Because the waterways, I think that would technically include all of the lakes. Because they're all connected to each other. And then finally we have the lair of the Hollow King. Not to be confused with the court of the Crimson King. That's a different place. And a different king. Actually, I guess I might as well go ahead and do the House of Baffle. I have everything I need. You know, the double jump and the spider gloves. And there's some signs in here that have some poetry. If you are interested. Again, I advise playing the game. Of course, I'm spoiling all of the secrets now, so... hopefully, if you're interested, you've already played. Alright, so go ahead and go through this door, grab this gem. And then these doors have signs next to them with Roman numerals, so we have to keep falling until we get to the 27th door. And this is one that took some figuring out, let me tell ya. There are hints to it. You see the number 27 written in Roman numerals from time to time. So there's 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, and when you get to the 27th one, it has some more poetry. Too long divorced from the longing to sell it right. All I got now is this apathetic veneer. It might not age as gracefully as I wanted to, but I can recall almost everything here. I don't know what a lot of the poetry means, or what point it's trying to make. And I know poetry doesn't have to have a point, but you know, it should evoke something. And I guess it kind of evokes a general sense of disappointment in oneself, and like the desire to do better for yourself, which I can definitely relate to, but a lot of it comes across a little, I'm not sure the right word, melodramatic, I guess. I mean, I'm not one to judge, you know, I'm not a poet, I'm not in anything. I'm just a schmuck what plays video games for the Intertron. Oh hey, there's the mask. Oh, is this whole area silent? That's a bummer. Alright. So the only other thing that's in here is a gem. And since I'm not going for 100%, I'm not going to bother with that. Normally, you would have to stand on that turtle as it very slowly crawls across those spikes, and then those signs are like the developer apologizing for it. It's a pretty good joke. I laughed the first time I stumbled across this place, but yeah, not going for 100%, don't need that gem. And that is it for the House of Baffle. That was a checkpoint I hit, by the way. When you heard that little, the little ding-a-ling noise. Yeah, I don't want to shit on the writing in this game because it's, you know, it's a part of the game that was personal. And this was an arduous project for the developer, from what I understand, and it's meaningful to the person who made it, so you know, it's worth playing to see that stuff. Where am I going? I wanted to go back to the ice dungeon, which is up here, right? Yeah. No? No, that's Sky Pillars. So, the ice dungeon is probably over here. Yeah, the Glacial Palace. Alright, got all that stuff. Wait, I might as well. Like, if it's not too far out of the way, I might go for some of the gem. Oh wait, that's like way up there. Okay. Because I will need at least some gems to buy keys, but they only cost two gems apiece, so I probably have all of the gems I will need for the duration of the game. Yeah, you're not supposed to have the double jump or the spider gloves when you come here, so This whole place is just my playground. Oh, I wonder what happens if I come here before I talk to the scientist. So yeah, normally this is where you get the winged boots. And there's a scientist in the lodge who asked you to check on the status of the Arcadian who came this way. And he will reward you with a gem if you bring him news of the Arcadian's demise. Hopefully, since I did that first, the plot flag would just still be triggered. And I won't have to come back here. Of course, if it's just a gem, then I won't have to worry about it anyway. But if it's an item that I need, then I'll have to make another trip. There's the scuba gear. Wow. I think there's one more item that we need to finish the game. And then it's just tracking down the pieces of the King's Heart. Like, you don't need the red or the blue orbs. I need the caustic catalyst, the acid catalyst, something like that, which once you get the scuba gear, I think it's like the steel skin catalyst. Once you get the scuba gear, the catalyst lets you go into lava and poisonous water. And then I think that's it. Like, there's a skeleton key, which is unnecessary. There has to be something I'm forgetting. Oh well. I'm sure it will come to me. Oh yeah, well, you need the letter or the ticket to enter the underworld, but it's quite possible that I won't need anything in the underworld, so that's like not guaranteed to be a thing. It probably will be. Like, statistically, it's very likely that at least one of the heart pieces will be in the underworld. But you never know. I might be able to skip that part. Yeah, let's go ahead and do this. So, you need to release this to protect you from the bullets. And you need to actually stay behind it. Is there another checkpoint anywhere? Make this a little easier? No, not over here. Over here? Yeah, there it is. Oh yeah, I don't have the Tesla badge yet, which I might end up not needing. Like, if nothing that I need is behind an electric barrier, then I can just not worry about it. Yeah, grab a key. Why not? I like keys. Keys open doors. I learned that in a tutorial once. So, instead of spring heel boots, we get the key. And then this is one of the other two doors. See, you can see in my inventory, I have the mask with like the crying face on it, which is the same face that's on the door. So, a little confusing. Like, the first time I ever played this randomized, I hadn't 100% of the game in a while, and I had no idea. Like, I was like, why isn't the mask opening the door? And because I hadn't gotten the A yet, and then eventually I found the A, and I was like, oh. So this is a special little area. And, oh, one of the pieces of heart is up there. Excellent. Doesn't play like the full jingle. It just has like a little kind of musical heartbeat stinger. But yeah, heart times one. So we have five more to go. Alright, I won't read from the book, but I will return to the entrance. Like, I can probably just leave at this point, but, like, there still might be another piece of the heart or something that I'm really going to need. And I've definitely left dungeons prematurely. I was like, oh, the only thing left in here is gems. I can just get out of here. And then I end up missing a really important item, and I have to come back and find it later. So even though it's not 100% efficient, like, while I'm here, I might as well just quickly go through the rest of it. Alright, there's a gem down there. I'm missing two. Okay, so there's one. It's interesting that it gives you a way, like, you can play the whole game without getting the red and the blue orbs. Just, there's going to be some things that you have to wait for. But not this one. This one, you can just, well, you would need the double jump boots. So, well, I guess you could do it with just the spider globe. Actually, you can just make that jump. You don't need anything. Dang. Alright, I think we have seen everything in the Glacial Palace. And yeah, there are very few parts of the game that actually require the Tesla badge either. Like, you could do a very minimalistic run of this game. Like, you don't need the Tesla badge to get through there, just wait for it to stop. It's interesting. Okay, good deal. Alright, I think that is it for the Glacial Palace. Yep. So, where to next? I think I will jump back into Subcon here. And now that I have the mask, I can go on ahead and finish out Lakewood Dungeon. Which I don't need anything else here. So fastest way to do this is to actually, yeah, this will work. This music loop could probably stand to be a little longer. It's not quite Fatal Labyrinth levels of short, but I feel like there should be a little bit more to it. So yeah, now that we have the mask, we can see these disappearing blocks and do a really potentially frustrating section. I've done this a few times recently, so I'm better equipped than I usually am. Nope. You can sort of stand on the edge of these blocks, but you have to be, like, right on the right pixel. And in my experience, it's easier to just try to wall jump your way. Why did I go after that gem? I knew I didn't need that gem. And yet I cannot resist the shiny object. Tis my curse as a video game player. Alright. There's nothing else down here, is there? Now that I have the checkpoint? No. I didn't think so. I should have gone for the checkpoint first, even if I did want the gem. Oh, I don't have the Tesla badge yet. I can't do this. I forgot. There's an electric barrier here. That's a bummer. Especially since I got this checkpoint. Because now I have to go all the way back. The hard way. This isn't the first time this has happened to me either. Piece of cake. There is a debug option to return to the overworld when you play Rando, but I'm not going to be using any of the debug options unless I absolutely have to. Like if it ends up being an actual glitch. Alright, so we might be back here and we might not. It depends on if there turns out to be a critical item past that electric force field. Which there very well may be. Oh yeah, I have the scuba gear. I can just kind of go wherever now. Well, not wherever. How many keys do I have? 4? Okay. Yeah, the underwater... The subterranean waterways are gigantic and sprawling and very maze-like, and all of the outdoor water areas connect to it at some point. And eventually, this is normally where you find the Tesla badge, and eventually I think you need all of the mobility upgrades to completely explore the waterways. Because the darker water was acidic or caustic or poison or whatever the video game thing is in this case. I think it's poison. Well, that's everything for Lakewood, pretty much. Unless I do end up having to go back to Lakewood Dungeon. Which I won't worry about that now. Actually, I can do most of the stuff here in the fishing village. Okay, so that's just a gem down there, which means I don't need the catalyst. Because there's no other reason to go down there other than to get that item. Yeah, if you're doing a 100% run, then that means you have to do all of this. And this is where you normally find the steel skin catalyst, but in this case, it's just a gem. And there's no book to get out of here. I guess that's like a teaching moment, because you have the steel skin catalyst and now you can take the easy way to get past the shrimp instead of having to go back through the bullets. See, I shouldn't have gotten that checkpoint, because if I didn't, I could have just death warped back to that one. Hello. Pardon me. Alright, 3 keys left. And there are still, like, 3 shops where I can buy 2 keys apiece. So, I'm not going to have to worry about keys. And I can always borrow one, too. If I really need to, which I can't imagine that happening. I guess if you really wanted an annoying challenge, you could do a run that's all borrowed keys, where you just never find keys in the dungeons, and you just always go back to a keylender every single time you need a key. I just wanted to fill in that last corner of the map there. I knew there was nothing there. Push enter when landing on a mushroom to get a big boost. Oh, it's all capital letters except for the name of the key that you press. I said big boost because it was in all caps, but it turns out it's all caps. So yeah, the waterways have all of these doors that connect to each other that take you to other parts of the dungeon, and it's just a big mess. I like to save the waterways for as late as possible. Just because there are so many different sections that require so many different upgrades. Which at this point I have everything except for the catalyst. So I could explore all of the waterways except for the parts under the poisonous water. But you know, you might as well, if possible, wait until you can explore all of it. Alright, so that's just a gem over there. So don't have to worry about that spot. I think there's an item in this cave. And then that fellow down there, fellow or lady, possibly, gives you a hint about, I think, the secret in the ice caves. If I were doing 100% run, this would be necessary. Right now it's not necessary. I'm just going after it for fun, because that gem is just slightly too high for you to get with a normal double jump. So you need the turtle boost. I like it. The game's trying to teach you patience. Oh, can I just get all the way across like that? For some reason, I never thought of doing that. Oh, okay. So you can go from left to right, but you can't go from right to left. Well, I don't know. Maybe I can. Yeah. Check me out. Look at my skills. Just totally cheese my way across there. That's interesting. So you don't need the bridges to get across if you have the spider gloves. Wait, I didn't want to go here yet. I want to go to the desert zone. Oh, just popping my head into the waterways. Delaying the inevitable. I don't know, the waterways aren't that bad, but it seems like if I'm going to get stuck, it's usually because there's a part of the waterways that I forgot to go to, that I needed some critical item. Just because it is so huge and sprawling, and there are a few secrets there. Revolver Crossing. Where you can revolver cross a lot. See how I'm doing. How am I doing, Fortune Teller? 51 minutes, 29 deaths, 39 gems, never owed a debt. seek out the Arcadian past Lakewood. I tried. Lord knows I tried. He went some mysterious red orb. I don't know where to get that thing. Alright, jeweler. I'll have a key and I will have another key. Thank you. I could pay 30 gems to get a gem. If I really wanted to. Yoink. Why would I borrow a key from you, Keylender? There's a key right there. This ain't a new place for the wayfaring kind. What a rude sign. Alright, so I can go to the Arcadian secret stash, which is right here. Secret cache, excuse me. Normally, you have to find the blue orb and return it to the Arcadian in the desert dungeon to know this is here. Unless you just luckily stumble across it. Yeah, this is normally where you find the magic snorkel. I think I called it scuba gear, but it's just a snorkel. I apologize. I don't think snorkels work that way. I don't think you can just stay underwater indefinitely with a snorkel. Alright, this is one of the easiest secrets to forget about. Once you have the scuba gear, there are two little sections here that you can get to. This one has a gem, and this one probably also has a gem, but I have to check. Yeah. Yeah, if you forget about this and there's an important item there, then you are in trouble. Oops. Alright, off to the desert dungeon. Yeah, there's really no hint that that's there. Like, you learn that this is here, there's a hint about this, but no one ever gives you a hint about this. You just kind of have to guess that you need to walk right there. I think this is the one thing in my first 100% run that I eventually ended up looking up. Or discovering, like, because I couldn't find those two gems anywhere. And I thought I looked everywhere, and like the existence of that land isn't enough to make me think that I can get onto it somehow, because it has like these sand dunes, but that's not like a thing that you can interact with normally. And you know, there are little islands scattered kind of around other parts of the world, so. Yeah, that's the one thing that I think the game could use a clue about. I mean, there are no islands around here other than those, but I think there are a few islands up in the ice zone that turned out to be nothing. So yeah, does not really give you any kind of hint about that. Ruins. Alright, let's go up here. I'm not supposed to be able to do this yet. I'm still very vulnerable to electricity, it turns out. Despite all my other awesome skills. I will ride this platform, though. I like how it keeps the tradition of headbanging alive that was established in You Have to Win the Game. You can't duck, but you can slightly bend your head. I guess that's a good visual indicator that that's a platform that you can't fall through. I just want to check something real quick. Sorry. The URL that I posted in the Discord isn't working. That's disappointing. Well, it's a good thing I'm recording this. Hello to everyone just tuning in live. I've been going for about an hour, and I didn't realize that I wasn't streaming because YouTube changed the way that it works since the last time I streamed. I had to actually click a button to go live, rather than just starting the stream being enough to trigger the go live functionality. I had to actually click the button. So I apologize for that, but you have that's me. you have an hour of archive to look forward to. I'm in the middle of this super win the game randomizer run. I probably shouldn't have even gone live at all at this point, because anyone who actually does start watching is going to be very confused, unless you haven't played this game, or unless you've played this game and you're familiar with the randomizer. Basically, to recap, this is an exploration platformer, and the developer added a randomizer mode in 2015 or so. Or the game came out in 2015. The randomizer mode was recently added. and I've done a few seeds, and I enjoy it. And the current seed is the one you see on the overlay there. The VRTM KBTD. If you want to wait to watch this until you can do the randomized seed, that's one option. I'm about halfway through the game. I have just about every essential item. I just need the catalyst to protect me from lava and poison water, and then I can start collecting the rest of the heart pieces. This is another Arcadian, similar to the one in the tower. And if you listen to a story, he will ask you to collect the blue orb, and he has a gem for you, which you can see on the mini map there. Oh boy, that sucks. I'm really not a fan of YouTube lately, but, you know, other than Twitch, YouTube is pretty much the only game in town as far as live streaming goes. The only one worth considering anyway. And it is slightly better than Twitch, so I'll stick with YouTube for now. So if you are just joining us, right now I am exploring the desert ruins, trying to find the the Steelskin Catalyst or other items that I might need to obtain the Catalyst or the other 5 pieces of heart, because I've only found 1 piece of the King's Heart so far. I'll probably do another seed after this, because this has been a relatively easy seed anyway. I mean, I was planning on doing that anyway, before I realized that I screwed up the stream. And like, the go live button on the YouTube interface is like the very top right corner of the screen. Like, it's not at all where you would expect it to be. So, like, it said stream quality excellent, and it showed my video, and so I thought, hey, everything's good. But everything was not good. And, you know, I don't want to load up my own stream while I'm streaming, because there's going to be a really annoying echo thing, and, like, I had no reason to believe I wasn't streaming. I mean, I was streaming. YouTube just wasn't showing it to people. Oh, it's frustrating. Anyway, hi to anyone who is watching the live stream now that you are able to. Fudge. Yeah, apologies for the late start for those of you who saw the announcement. Alright, there's nothing else over there. This classic from Super Mario Bros. 3. The Pipe World platform. I have keys, right? Heck yeah, I have keys. I have keys for days, but I still don't have the Tesla badge, so nothing important up there anyway. Alright, I want to get back on the Mario 3 platform, which means having to walk up there. Since I already got another checkpoint. Can't just do the cool speedrunner thing and death warp my way back. Alright, going ahead and open up the door for Subcon. Just in case I want to come back here later, make it easier on myself. The scorpions are invisible if you don't have the Mask of the Arcadians, but you can sort of cheese your way past them if you know they're there and you haven't found the mask yet. Also, these platforms are invisible if you don't have the mask, so you kind of have to watch where the devil head is shooting to see where it's safe to jump. Because normally, you know, you don't get the mask until much after this. Although there's nothing technically preventing you from going to all of the dungeons out of order. Oops. Okay, well. This is what happens if you read one of the books. I call this a cutscene. It is a playable section, but it doesn't really serve any purpose, so there's not a good reason to play these sections after the first time you see them. Those crushers always remind me of RAM chips. Like the old-fashioned kind of RAM chips. That's just like a circuit board with pins before they started putting all sorts of RGB lights and gamer flair on there. So yeah, there are some vague allusions to dreams and prophecies and stuff none of it super important, I guess. I think that's all I can do in this dungeon before I find the catalyst. There is one square on the map that I would like to fill in, just because I can. And that is this one over here. You read a sign that tells you that a leap of faith is required in the Great Hall, and it has an arrow pointing that direction, and a sign that says here. So, pretty good hints. And then the one up there, it's similar looking. So, even though the game doesn't explicitly tell you about that one, you can sort of suss it out. Excuse me. I'm gonna have to get a bottle of water after I finish the seed. Give my voice a rest. So yeah, I still don't have the red or the blue orbs, which means I cannot complete the Arcadian's quests. Which is a bummer, because I really need those gems. Alright, there is an under lava section that I might have to come back here to do later. But other than that, I'm done with the desert ruins. Love those dope fish. Very Homsar-like, but with teeth. Man, I can't believe I forgot to click the go live button. Like, I didn't really think it was that unusual that no one was chatting, because, you know, when you start streaming at 3 a.m. and most of the people who watch you are based in the U.S. or, you know, based in Europe where it's the time of day that they're at work and unable to watch, you know, I kind of expect not a lot of chat activity. So, you know, that wasn't immediately throwing up a red flag for me. Well, now I know. I'll have to not go another 9 months without streaming, and so the interface won't completely change on me. So I know what I'm doing. Sounds like a plan. Alright, time to go to Poison Swampland. I mean, it's a poison swamp, but it's also a swampland that is poisonous. Oh, I can't get that gem yet. Because I'm still not immune to electricity. Ha! Nice try. Alright, so this observatory has a scientist lady who asks me to fetch the spider gloves for her, which, since I already have the spider gloves, I can just collect my reward. How'd you get up here without climbing gloves? Because you don't have the red and blue blocks either. Oh, so you see how there's no gem on the minimap there, and I've already collected all the gems in this area. That means she actually has a non-gem reward for me. It's probably just a key, but it might be something exciting. Oh, there's someone else's spider gloves. Oh, she had a piece of the king's heart. Wow. Well, I'm very glad I came up here then. That's 2 out of 6. Alright, there's the Sky Pillars, which is the next dungeon to explore, but you also have this town up here. Oh well, there's the Tesla badge. I will just hop up and grab that real quick. And in this town, all the doors are locked because people are afraid of the evil. You said it, video game NPC. And I have 5 keys, so I could. I could open all of these doors. Yeah, there's no reason to open this one because it's just a key lender. There's nothing else in there, so you don't want to use a key to borrow a key. But I'll go in here. You did lock the door. I unlocked it with the key that I have. Alright, buy a couple keys from this person. It's a fortune teller here. Hour and 12 minutes, 45 deaths, 54 gems, never owed a debt, and a clever rapscallion. And seek out the Arcadian Pass Lakewood. I've been that way like 3 times. The Arcadian has not been any help. But it's okay. The fortune teller doesn't know that everything's randomized. No one told her. Alright, see what we have in store for us at the Sky Pillars. There's a hint that you can fall down this way. Because the astronomer tells you that there's something at the base of the Sky Pillars. And in this case, it's just a gem. Nothing important. There's nothing else down here, is there? No, just a bouncy mushroom. Sorry, YouTube is yelling something at me. I wish YouTube gave me all of this information before I started streaming. Oh crap, my controller just lost connection. Okay, there it goes. I was really worried I would have to set that up again. I'm using my 8-bit Do M30 controller, which is the sort of pseudo Sega Saturn shaped Genesis 6-button controller shaped pad, and I really like it. It's my favorite controller for anything that doesn't require analog sticks, but Bluetooth is a very finicky technology, and I find Bluetooth devices I have connected coming unconnected more often than I would like. So this is where you would normally find the spider gloves, not immediately, like I found them. I could plug the controller in, but it's USB-C, and the only USB-C cable I have is the one that came with it. And it's not long enough. I have plenty of real USB cables I could have used. But they had to make it USB-C for no reason. C'est la vie. Alright, here's the door to SubCon. So, these platforms, you need the Mask of the Arcadian to see, and there's a thing down here too. And you can sort of figure out how to get up here, even if you don't have the mask, but there's no reason to go up here because if you don't have the mask, then this Arcadian isn't here. So, this is where you would normally get the Avengers logo, but this time he has the key for me. So yeah, find the 6 pieces of the King's Heart. No. I know there's stuff around here. Okay. Looks like it's mostly keys. This is a weird checkpoint because it's possible to respawn and then immediately get hit by a bullet, like, multiple times like that. And it can potentially be a little frustrating. I think that's the only checkpoint in the game where you're not safe to respawn there anytime. Alright. Here's another place where you get the 27 hint, which will make sense to anyone watching live once you watch the archive. I mean, this might as well just be a pre-recorded video at this point. But that's okay. I like pre-recorded videos too. But I also like doing it live. It gives it a sense of urgency and immediacy. But even if no one's chatting, you know, there's always a possibility that someone might show up. Or someone might just be lurking. You know. Someone really famous and important could be watching me. I would never know. Alright, just gonna scour the sky pillars to make sure I don't miss anything. Because we still only have 2 pieces of heart, and the other 4 pieces could be anywhere. See? They could be anywhere. Like right there, for example. I don't like the protagonist's shirt being the same color as his hat in this. That's not how it is in the box art, is it? No, I guess it is. Yeah, they're both green. I'm pretty sure in You Have to Win the Game, they were 2 different colors, at least if you were playing in EGA mode. I don't know, both of them being the same color makes it look like a, I don't know, more uniform-like, I guess. Not uniform in the sense that they're the same, but like a uniform that you wear, like a, you know, this is my adventurer's uniform. They give this to you when you join the Adventuring Guild. I mean, I guess it's basically the same as Link in Zelda. Like, he has an all-green adventurer's uniform as well. I don't need that key. And I'm not gonna waste a lot of time trying to get it. I will get this key, though. I don't need that one either, but it's easier to get, which makes it a higher priority. Alright, I just want to go back through this door real quick and just make sure that I didn't miss anything. I have all of the gems in this area, but that doesn't mean that there's not an important item in some hard to reach place where there's normally just a gem. Okay. Alright, I'm confident that I explored 100% of this place, so. Let's we go, amigo. No. Also, it looks less like a backwards hat in this one. And more like, I don't know, some sort of beret. A green beret, if you will. Okay, well, I think we are done with Swamp Hole Land. So, what else do I have? Well, now that I have the Tesla badge, I wish I could bring in my status screen on the world map. You have to actually be in a location to do that. And now that I have a Tesla badge, I can check and see if there's anything I need in Lakewood Dungeon. In that one inaccessible part. Do this. It's going around this way because it's cooler. Whoa, I'm behind the UI. This must be like a super secret area. Of course, you can turn the UI off. That would be an interesting challenge, playing without the mini-map. You know, I've come to rely on it pretty extensively to make sure that I've explored everything and to give me information about where I might be missing objects. You know, learning the game well enough that you can play without the map, that would be a pretty impressive achievement. I don't know if it's one that I would be interested in achieving, but it is a potential challenge. All right, electricity. What secrets do you hide? Is it just going to be a few gems? Because if it is, I would be very sad. Alright, I don't want to hit that checkpoint because I've already been that way. So I want to come back here and just sort of casually I wanted to say hot dog my way up there. I don't know where that came from. I guess the vertical platform looks kind of like a hot dog. Like, it's roughly the same color as an uncooked hot dog. Roughly the same shape. I mean, it would be a very small hot dog. Or a very thick hot dog. It must be more like a Vienna sausage or something. But those tend to be a little paler in color, so I don't know. Ah, crud. Oh, crud and crap. What the? Also, I think hot dogging describes some sort of, like, it means something, right? Doesn't it mean, like, showing off? Like, oh, he's just hot dogging. So that would be another potential meaning of hot dogging my way up here. I have no idea that's real. Shout me out in the chat if that is the least bit actual. Alright, so I got the Underworld ticket. That's exciting. That was worth coming back here for. I know that sounds sarcastic, but I mean it. It really was. How do I get... There's a part of this map that I haven't been to yet. But I should have been able to go that way. Right, I couldn't do this because I didn't have the mask. Oh, might as well, while I'm here, see if there's anything else important. That's not important. That's a cool looking enemy. I like it when games have things that are just sort of random and you only see them once. Makes it feel a little bit more special. And there's the catalyst. Well, look at that. It says Mask of the Arcadians, but it's actually the Steel Skin Catalyst. And that's all we need. The four empty spaces on the item list are the red and the blue orbs, the skeleton key, which we definitely don't need, and the special amulet that you get when you collect all the gems, which doesn't do anything. It is just a trinket. Alright, well, now it is time to go heart hunting. And I'm betting that most of the pieces of heart I need are going to be either in the underwater passageway or in hell territory. And I think I will do hell territory first, because even though the levels are frustrating, it's at least straightforward and I'm not going to get lost there. So normally you get the ticket to Hell World. So normally this is a skeleton key, this item that you can buy for 30. And then after that, you can buy this for 20. And once you buy it, you show it to the shopkeeper to teleport to Hell World. But since I just found it, I don't have to spend the 50 gems. I can just use it. The Underworld Hostel. Yeah, when I'm ready to go back, I just come in here and I jump through that portal. This is mostly why I call it Hell World, on account of all the lava. And some of these levels are hard. Nothing in this game is, like, massacre levels of hard. Like, I wouldn't put anything in this game on the same level as, like, Vanny Vidi Vici in VVVVVV. But there are a couple sections that can be a little nerve-wracking. But I should be okay. Hole in the World. So I've definitely not found important items here before. So I want to be extra careful that I explore every nook and cranny. Well, every nook at least. Every cranny, if I have time. There is a secret passage right here that is not very well telegraphed. I'm not sure why anyone would try to go this way, but I did randomly, and I found a teeny tiny little crab and a gem. But if that gem is an important item, then you better know about that. Which is the recurring theme of randomizer mode. You better know about it. You might not have to, but you better. There's not a thing over here, is there? No. Okay. Ooh, creepy eyes in the background. Although this music's a little jauntier than I was expecting for Hell World. The overworld theme, I think, is appropriate. Very satanic sounding. Damn it, you couldn't just stop moving, like, half an inch sooner. So one interesting thing about the music in this game is that it is all programmatic. Like, this is a very small download. Like, this entire game is just a few megabytes. So rather than composing music in like Famitracker or something, which is, I imagine, how most people would make NES style music, and then it would spit out like an OGG or an MP3 or something to use. All of the music is in Engine, which is an original engine programmed in, I want to say C++ or maybe C#. Like, I read something about the development of this game once because I was interested in how, you know, a relatively modern game, you know, this came out in 2014. Even modern games with like sort of a retro 8-bit quote unquote aesthetic, which this is definitely going for a Famicom NES aesthetic. You know, it's not just generic 8-bit, like, it is carefully designed to evoke the color palette and the musical stylings of the NES. You know, most games of that sort would be made in like Unity or something. Like, they would probably use some 8-bit, 8-bit styled, I don't know what they call it in Unity, plugins, I guess? Just modules that people made to make this kind of thing easier, to do pixel art and I imagine that most of them would use an external tool to compose the music and just have a bunch of OGGs in there, and the game would be, you know, hundreds of megabytes because it has to use the whole Unity framework and all of the big data files. But this game is, you know, I'm not going to say I know exactly what goes into programming a game like this, because that's not my specialty. But, you know, it's not a bunch of pre-built modules and MP3s and stuff. It's it was all sort of hand-coded, which, I mean, I'm sure that, you know, it uses libraries or whatever. You know, it's not like it was programmed in assembly or something, but you know, it makes a game that should have a small file size be a small file size, you know? I'm always a little disappointed when these retro-style games are built in these massive frameworks that, you know, even though they're seeking to emulate a game or a style of game, that would have only been a few hundred kilobytes on a ROM cartridge, you know, if that. The way that they're developed, they tend to have a lot of overhead, and they require better hardware to run than, you know, one would expect. And this game, you know, it still runs pretty well, and I mean, it'll run on pretty much any computer, and it even runs, like, pretty well on Windows XP. Like, it is small and lightweight, but still, you know, a full, quote-unquote, 8-bit game experience. I don't know why. I'm going for that gem. I don't need one. I could have just death warped to this checkpoint. But I was feeling spiteful towards those fish. And of course, you know, this isn't to knock anyone who uses Unity or Unreal. Like, I assume Unreal has support for, like, 2D games now, right? Because people are using them to make App Store games and stuff. And I'm sure some of those are simple and two-dimensional. Because Unity, originally, I think Unity and Unreal were both pretty much just 3D game engines. And I think it was sort of the rise of mobile that pushed them towards supporting more 2D kind of SDKs. Pardon me while I take a sip of beverage. Okay. Alright, this one sucks. And there are never any items in this level, but you have to complete it to unlock the rest of the levels in Hell World, so I'd say this is probably the closest thing this game has to, like, a Vanny Vidivici kind of thing. Like, it's not that hard, but it's a lot of trial and error. And making it look a bit easier than it is, because I've done this several times recently-ish. Oh, jaunty music. But yeah, I mean, use whatever tools you know how to use to make a game. You know, I'm not saying don't make a game like this in Unity, but when a game like this is the file size that I expect it to be, it's appreciated. And, you know, we'll run on a crappy computer, because I'm playing my desktop right now, and, you know, my desktop is not it's not old or weak or anything, but, you know, sometimes I want to play games on my laptop, which doesn't have a video card. It's just all onboard Intel graphics, and sometimes even 2D games that I expect should run on my laptop don't, because, you know, there's just a lot of overhead required for stuff like Unity. It's expecting I'd say at that point the bottleneck is probably my processor rather than the lack of the video card. Because it is about, you know, a 5-year-old laptop. But, you know, I shouldn't need a new powerful processor to play a 2D game. I mean, unless it has all kinds of, like, visual effects and, like, HDR crap in there and stuff, which, you know, hey, piece of heart, nice. We are at 4 out of 6. There's a secret here, which is very easy to miss or forget about. But if you miss this one, you won't be getting very far, because there's a lock there. So, eventually, you're going to have to kind of beat your head against this level until you figure it out. I'm not a fan of development tools becoming more and more unnecessarily complex, requiring more and more hardware to do basically the same thing. And this is mostly a problem when it comes to the web, but I feel like it's affecting game development a little bit as well. Well, there's the skeleton key, which I don't really need, but I might as well show how to get that item, just for future reference for anyone watching. You have to hit that invisible block first. I think Unity's probably been a huge boon. I mean, it's definitely been a huge boon for independent 3D game development, which is what it was originally intended for. You know, Unity 3D, they kind of only added the 2D paradigm much later on. But for 2D development, I don't have a lot of experience with it. I've messed around with the free version to see how hard it is to do certain things, or how easy it is to do certain things. And I honestly don't see why anyone would pick it for 2D game development over Game Maker. Honestly, like, Game Maker is not perfect, but it's pretty powerful, and I feel like it doesn't, like I'm speaking from a place of ignorance, you know, I've never developed a game with Unity, but it just looks like a lot of unnecessary complexity. Which, maybe for some kinds of 2D games, that complexity is necessary, and I don't know what I'm talking about, but for like a platformer or something, I don't know. I'm probably just old. I'm not old, I'm 35. Why would I say that? I feel like people start saying that they're old once they hit like 25, and then they kind of never stop. Like, that's the point at which, you know, they're no longer adolescents. You know, they're past that phase of their life, and at various times, people tend to think that they're old, or at least I do, but I'm not old. I have, like, at least half my life ahead of me. That's awesome. Alright, and that is it for Hell World. This seems to be an ideal hiding spot, says the note. And then that one up at the top is just a book you can read if you want. There's nothing important there. All right, so we have what? Four pieces? No, we have 5 out of 6 pieces of heart. So only one more to go. And I bet it's going to be in the underwater, or, you know, the subterranean waterways. Because I have barely explored them. Which I'm kind of glad I haven't had to explore them that much. Like, it's always a bummer when there are a lot of important items in the waterway. Just because it's such a hassle to get around. Good music, though. Now see, this secret is pretty well telegraphed, because you can see on the map that you can keep going down, and this section of floor looks pretty distinct from the rest of it. That must be the giant fish the lady in the fishing village was talking about. Alright, well, that was fruitless, but don't worry. There's 5 other dozen directions we can go. I don't know. I'm sure Unity has been a great asset to all types of small developers. But, you know, it's also a product, you know, it's also a corporation. And sure, they have free licenses for small developers. But as soon as you hit a certain number in sales, then you have to suddenly start forking over for the big license, you know? I mean, they're a business. They are in it for the profit. And, like, it's cool that they make those tools available on a, you know, less restrictive licensing agreement. I mean, you still have to show the Unity logo and everything, but, you know, it's always bad when one corporation's way of doing things kind of becomes the dominant paradigm. Okay, so it's off limits due to high levels of acidity. So it's acid, not poison. Got it. And there's the subcon door. I was playing some off-road Velociraptor Safari the other day, which is a very early Unity game. And let me tell you, that was one file, you know, well, one file running in Flashpoint, which is, you know, sort of a modern emulator. It's not really emulating, it's more of like a virtual machine, I guess, that makes it easy to play a lot of browser-based games, mostly, you know, for Flash games, as you would expect from the name, but it also has Unity support. And, you know, off-road Velociraptor Safari is a fully three-dimensional game that at one point was meant to load in a browser window, and it's like 8 megabytes for the whole thing. And it's a pretty smooth experience. Of course, you know, in 2007, when internet speeds weren't so great, that would have seemed relatively large. Well, I guess anyone, but by 2007, most people were at least on some sort of DSL or cable connection. And 7 or 8 megabytes wouldn't have been a big deal. Would have been a big deal to anyone who was still on dial-up. But yeah, Unity is quite a different beast from what it used to be. And, you know, again, not shitting on anyone who uses Unity, you know. The best tool available is the one that works for you to do the job that you need it to do. And depending on your situation, that could be Unity, that could be GameMaker, it could be PuzzleScript. It could be Microsoft Visual Studio. It could be writing some Python in a text document, you know? Whatever tool enables you to make the thing that you want. I just worry that a lot of people kind of default to Unity because that's like the dominant thing. You know, everything's made in Unity now. I think even the new, like, one of the new Pokemon games, or one of the more recent Pokemon games, I think it might have been one of the Mystery Dungeon ones, or like multiple ones, I'm not even sure, are made in Unity. You know, this is Nintendo. Well, sort of. It's Game Freak / Nintendo. And it's kind of weird that even Nintendo is sort of going down this path, following this paradigm on their own hardware. And I'm not saying Unity is a bad tool to make a game like that with, but I don't know. It strikes me as weird. That's all. The Doom ports that came out on Switch recently. The ones that were infamously terrible before they went in and fixed them. Those were Unity. Despite there being like a dozen source ports of Doom out there. Of course, all of those require open source licensing agreements. But, I mean... You can sell Doom in an open source. I mean, the Doom engine is open source. And all of the, like, all of the Doom engines, you know, the modern ones, like, none of their licensing agreements, I think, would forbid them from selling the game. Because, like, well, I guess it's Microsoft now, but, you know, Bethesda /id/ Microsoft, they still have the rights to the games themselves, you know, all of the game assets. And they could sell, like they could take, like, GZ Doom, just as an example, or, you know, Chocolate Doom, or Vanilla Doom, or not Vanilla, Vanilla Doom is just Doom, but, Chocolate Doom, or Crispy Doom, or whatever, and, you know, use that as like a starting point instead of having to make a completely new Doom engine from scratch in Unity. And I don't understand why they wouldn't do that. Or, like, I don't understand why they would make this completely new, this brand new engine with problems when there are numerous existing engines and frameworks they could have used. Because the Switch, it's like an ARM processor, right? I don't know exactly which processor it is, but like it's not dissimilar from ones used in like Android devices, and I'm sure plenty of those engines have been ported to Android, so I don't know, it's just weird. And it feels like Unity's taking over the world. Unity and or Unreal. And, you know, there are plenty of free or open source development kits for small game developers that, you know, aren't tied into a corporation like that, but I feel like no one ever talks about them. I have no idea which ones are good. You know, if I wanted to make a 2D platformer, I would just use Game Maker, because that's what I've used, you know. I'm trying to think of the names of the other ones. I guess the big one would be Godot? Is that what it's called? G-O-D-O-T? Or is it Godot? Godot? I don't know. Like, I read somewhere that the play Waiting for Godot is not actually pronounced Godot. And like, it sure looks like it should be pronounced Godot, doesn't it? But maybe, like, it's not like a French name. I don't know the origins of it. And I think Mandelbrot, the mathematician, as in the Mandelbrot set, I think that should actually be pronounced Mandelbro. I don't know. Pronunciations are weird. I'm talking about a lot of things that I previously only read about, which means I have no idea how it's said. Oh, yeah, that one door up at the top, I thought that was the exit out of the dungeon, but that's not how this dungeon works. So there has to be an actual room there, and that must be where the last gem is. I mean, I don't need that gem, but there might be another item there that I do need. Which, I mean, at this point, that would just be the piece of heart. Where does this go? Okay, yeah, that's where I want to be. Why didn't I go this direction before? I really should have. Okay, just a gem, so I'm fairly confident at this point that I've explored all of the waterways. I don't think there are any other secrets, so the last piece of heart might be in one of these underwater lake areas. Oh, actually, you know where it might be? I haven't even gone down the path to get to the Hollow King's lair, because you need the Steel King catalyst to basically get anywhere. Have I just not been across this bridge? I guess not. Weird. I've always taken the South Bridge. Oh, I didn't have to jump there. Plenty of clearance for that dope fish. Wait. Oh, never mind. And there's nothing up here. Right? Yeah. Okay. an uneventful bridge. Alright, yeah, let's check out this cave formation up here. Nope, just some gems here. So yeah, if you didn't have the catalyst, you would be stymied as soon as you got to this area. The second arc of fire. I guess I can show off the Hollow King's lair. What happens if you go there before you have all the heart pieces? So yeah, you can't even easily platform your way over there if you wall climb all the way up here and double jump. You can see 5 out of 6, and this door's not open yet. So, no reason to come here at all until you find the 6th heart piece. And then once you do, the rest of the game from that point on is always the same. There's no randomization after the Hollow King's lair because there are no more plot critical items. Oh, that's a gem. I'm not even going to pick that up. I do not need that. Wait, there's a secret. Yeah, there is a secret here somewhere. Yeah, here it is. And it's just a gem. Or is it? Yes, it is. Well, there's the blue orb. Don't really need that at this point. Where is this? Oh yeah, glacial shelf. Oops. This guy says he dropped a gem down the pit. Guess it's gone forever now. Shows what he knows. Yeah, I never did go in that cave, did I? Oh, you know what? I never talked to the scientist. I bet the scientist has it. Wait. Yeah, I'm gonna go up here. Yeah, because I couldn't go there yet because I didn't have the key. Or I didn't have a key. And I said I would go back and I never did. I mean, I assume he's a scientist. He looks like a scientist. He says that he's doing research. I guess he could be a scholar. What? Why did I want to say scholar? That's not how you say that word. Unless you're Sean Connery. May he rest in peace. Penguin is still shy. Oh yeah, I have the skeleton key now. And I need keys even less than ever. But I'll buy 2 keys from the jeweler anyway. Just, you know, I'm visiting the lodge. It's only polite that I buy something. How many gems do I have? 81? Eh, I might as well buy the 2 gems. So, I'll buy 1 gem for 30 gems. And then I'll buy another gem for 20 gems. And of course, normally that's the ticket to the underworld. So, she gives the explanation. Talk to me when you're ready to go to the underworld. And the fortune teller is probably still telling me to seek the Arcadian past Lakewood, right? Because I still haven't found the red orb. I forgot to grab the blue one. Need to go back for that. Yeah, I guess that's why I think he's a scientist, because he's wearing glasses, he has crazy hair, and he says he wants to compare notes. Oh, that is just a gem. Okay. Well, I am still at a loss for where the sixth piece of art could be. I never went lava diving in the desert ruins or liquid dungeon. So that would probably be the next step. But I just want to go back here real quick and grab that blue orb. Not that I need it, but... I feel kind of silly for passing it up. Nope, that's not the right way. Yeah, finding all the gems in this game without any kind of guide. I had to have had to look up more than one thing. Cause like, I don't know how I would have known that gem was there on Errol's Road unless I got lucky and I just happened to fall into the lava in the exact spot I needed to. Another thing that you sometimes have to watch out for is when it looks like there's a spot on the map that's been cleared, but you didn't actually see that entire screen. Like, if you just barely step onto the screen and then you quickly step back, it'll uncover it on the map, but you could still be missing something there, hypothetically. Alright, back to Liquid Dungeon, I guess. It's faster to go through Subcon to get where I need to be. Liquid Dungeon is over here. Yeah, I'm still missing two gems, which means I'm possibly missing other items as well. Dang it, I hate this part. Like, it really looks like they're okay. Now I need to not mess that part up. The Hollow King still rules a Hollow Land. I didn't know dope fish could live in lava. Good for them. I'm glad they're adaptable. I mean, I guess I can live in lava too now. Does this mean I've evolved to thrive in a harsh environment? I don't know exactly what the steel skin catalyst is. Like, its icon is just like a hazard symbol. Like, is it a potion that I drink that makes my skin tougher? Is it some sort of thin film that I apply to my body to keep out the elements? Oh yeah. The world may never know. Yeah, I want to fall down here. Oh yeah, there's a whole to-do over here. Okay, so this platform is going to take off really quickly. And so is this one. And that one. Alright, that is a gem. And I'm going to say that's this dungeon. Which means it is back to the desert ruins now. To go lava diving there. And then if the heart's not there, I don't know where to check. I feel like I've been everywhere at this point. Been everywhere thoroughly. Dang it, I really hope I can get out of here by climbing up this wall. I think I can, yeah. Yeah, I'm gonna go. Wait. No, I want to go through Subcon. Yeah, this is where randomizers get exciting, where it's just you revisiting the same locations over and over again, trying to find the one critical item that you missed. Still have no idea where the red orb could be. Who knows? I could give the blue orb, or show the blue orb to the Arcadian while I'm here. Even though I know all he has is a gem. It's the polite thing to do. Hey, I found your thing. Mm-hmm. Okay. Right, treasures. Ooh, another realm? A wizard worked on Mortal Kombat? Yeah, I'm a wayfarer. Yes, I do. I just need the heart. Yeah, you kind of do. Okay, so normally that's where you would find out about the Arcadian's hidden cache. Alright, lava time. I like a good lava bath. I always feel refreshed afterwards. Like, it really exfoliates, you know? You do have to be careful, because lava is hot. And this is this little section just outside the desert ruins. The screen looks kind of like a stomach. Something about, like, the shape of this cavern. I feel like I'm inside a stomach. It's like x-rayed through someone's body. I don't know. If that's someone's stomach, then they're having a bad time. Oh, there's nothing down here. Man. You see, you think there's going to be something down here because you have this very challenging eyeball monster you have to get past. This bullet hell eyeball. And then it's just a book. No, I'm not reading from the book. Oh, well, that's it for the desert ruins. Explored all of this. Was there somewhere that I saw a heart but forgot to grab it? Like, that's quite possible. I saw the blue orb and I forgot to grab that. But that was like very important. I mean, that was not very important. A piece of heart would be very important. Of course, I'm not used to playing and talking at the same time, so it's quite possible that I got distracted while I was ranting about Unity or something, and I just was totally oblivious to it. Well, I think my best bet at this point unless I miss something in one of the towns somehow. That seems even less likely. I think I have to go back into Hell World. Because I'm like 90% sure that I've searched all of the Glacial Palace, all of Lakewood Dungeon. Alright, let's see if there's anything in Hell World. See, it can be a little confusing because like the two dots that could indicate the exit out of the area, or it could indicate a door to a place that you actually haven't been. Is there a secret somewhere that I forgot about? That is quite possible. Like, I thought I knew all the secrets. It really looks like you should be able to drop through that platform. Well, I guess not really. It's quite a different color than the ones you can drop through. But it does look odd that there's like a break in the brick floor there. A lot of the secret areas don't show up on the map. So you can't just trust the map the whole time. Alright, that's just an exit. Just wanted to make sure. Alright, there's never an item here. Okay, this is 2 out of 2. And I'm pretty sure this level should normally have more than just 2. Alright, I already opened that lock that exits the level. I did go through the secret passage in the ice. I'm pretty sure there's nothing else in here. That's not a direction. None of these are safety spikes. Are these amoeba, or are they vinyl records that are really badly warped? I think either answer is equally likely. This is when randomizers get frustrating. Backtracking everywhere, trying to figure out exactly what you missed. Alright, I think the last hurrah normally has 5 gems. But, you know, at the same time, it could just be a key or something that I already got. That's where the skeleton key was, I think. I mean, I say frustrating. I'm not frustrated yet. But if this goes on for another 2 hours, then, you know, at that point, I will become frustrated. And I'll probably just look at the spoiler log to see what I missed and consider this run a failure. And hope for better luck on the next run. But I'm not there yet. And I did get whatever this was. There's nothing else over to the left, right? No. See, this is the point where being able to go to the overworld would be really handy. And part of me wonders if that should just be a feature of the game. Just if it's a level you've already quote-unquote finished, you know, Super Mario World style, be able to hit start select and just exit the level. But it says debug, so I'm going to continue treating it as a debug for now. I don't know where else I should check, though. There's nothing in here, by the way, just in case anyone was wondering. This is here to activate a secret later on. It's going to end up just being some random cave. I forgot to go in. Catacombs of Hope. I don't see what's very hopeful about this place. Thank you. Like, there's some people that you talk to, and they just give you an item for free. But I'm pretty sure I got all of those. The very first time I did the randomizer, I wondered if the key lender could potentially lend you things besides keys. See, there's an island out there that you can't get to. You have no reason to believe you can just go to some random island next to the desert. Yeah, I already got that. Oh, I never went underwater here. Oh. Well, there's two gems here. And I think that's what's normally in Frostbite Pass. But there could be something else. Well, there's a locked door. That's promising. Alright, there's a secret thing here that you have to fall through spikes to get to. I forgot about this because the last couple random seeds I played didn't require anything down here. So I let it slip my mind. You see, no matter how well you know a game, stuff will slip your mind. But, you know, if you do enough random seeds, eventually you'll remember everything. There's the red orb. And I know the red orb isn't necessary to get the last piece of heart. But there might be something over to the right. Awesome. The very first upgrade in the game. It's mine. And this isn't where the heart piece is. Okay, well, that's still encouraging. I still found something I was missing, even if it's not the thing that I need. And there's nothing else when I go through that door, right? It just leads to that gem. There's not like a secret path to the left, no. Oh, well, this is a fine kettle of fish. That's the thing cool people say, right? Now I kind of want to double check all of the bridges. Make sure that I thoroughly went down into all of the underwater areas. Right, I already found this secret. I don't think there's another secret here. I never got that, but that's just a gem. There's no, like, secret underground place here, right? I bet it's in the subterranean waterway somewhere. I bet even though I thought I explored the whole thing, I bet I missed something. I always miss something here. There's not another door over there. That's not a secret. So there's another door here in Stemmin's community, but all she does is give you hints about where the heart pieces are, which, you know, you would think that's what I want, but none of that applies to the randomizer, which is why I never went in there. I did this, right? I think I didn't get that gem. But I did get whatever was past the shrimp. And there aren't like other items down here, right? I think that's a shrimp. It might be a lobster. I don't know. It doesn't have claws. Well, I was going to do another seed after this, but I didn't think I shouldn't have hit that bell. I didn't think I was going to get stymied to the extent that I am. On this last heart piece. I think this is nothing. It looks like it might be something, but I'm pretty sure it's not. Oh. I guess if you look at the map right before the music starts, you can cut it off. I feel like I'm missing some sort of secret. Here. Like some sort of place where you can fall through the floor where it's not entirely obvious. Like I know I got the obvious one where you fall through the floor. I feel like there's also a non-obvious one. But where? And I could be totally off base. But I remember there being amoebas there. Amoebas and electricity. And it was somewhere in the waterways. Amoebas and electricity. That narrows it down. And I don't really have any hints on the map. Yeah, whenever you see a door that's surrounded by dirt like that, that means it's a door to the outside somewhere. Outside of the waterways. See, if you play a lot of a randomizer and there's a place that you almost never need to go, it's really easy to forget about it. And then when it does come up and it is a place you need to go, it can challenge your assumptions about how much you know about the game. Which is interesting, you know, that's sort of inherently what I find interesting about randomizers. You know, they force you to play a different way than you're used to, and think about the game in a different way than you usually do. But it can also be a headache. I knew that would go outside. I was just wondering what part of outside it went to. Man, the seed started out so easy, too. Like, I've had seeds where it took me forever to find the double jump boots or the spider claw, and I could hardly go anywhere. This time I had both of them right off the bat, but this still might not be a seed that I'm going to win, just because there's some spot that I'm forgetting about. And one of the questions I have to ask myself is, when is the appropriate point to throw in the towel? Because I was expecting to go for about 4 hours, which would have been two-hour streams. I can keep going down over there. Or wait, no, I can't. Shit. I got all excited because I thought this part kept going down. But it doesn't. So yeah, I would say, once I hit the 2 hour mark, or the 4 hour mark, if I haven't finished by then, I've been going for 2 hours and 42 minutes right now. Sorry, I'm thinking. Thank you. Is there another way I can keep going down inside of the secret area? Is that what it is? Is there more than just that book? I think the place with all the amoeba or amoebas, I don't know what the correct way to talk about more than one amoeba is. It's probably amoeba with an E at the end, and I'm never sure how to pronounce that. Amoebe? That doesn't sound right. Amoebe? Because with antenna, people usually say antennae. But I don't think that's correct. I think it's just, like, the commonly agreed on thing. Like, octopi is the commonly agreed on way to talk about more than one octopus. And that's not correct. Because the U.S. and octopus, I don't think that's a Latin suffix. I think that's Greek. And Greek doesn't change a U.S. to an I. So I'm pretty sure it's octopodes. But someone said octopi once and it stuck. Oh boy. I don't know if I can go past the 3-hour mark if I don't figure out something. I might end it then. You know, go into the debug menu just to see where was it, what I could have possibly missed, and let that be a lesson for next time. Because much like a roguelike, even in failure, we will have learned something in the process. And roguelikes are the most random randomizers of them all. I can't wait until someone makes a rogue randomizer. The game really needs a randomizer. Sometimes I look for, like, suspicious gaps in the map. Like, there's a gap between, like, right above this room that looks like there might be something there, but I'm pretty sure there's not. I guess if I do throw in the towel, I should at least go try to find the thing. See, this is what I hate about the waterways. Because the way those doors can lead basically anywhere in the dungeon, it turns it into a teleporter maze. One moment. Oh, excuse me. I should have been better prepared with a drink. I was expecting to have finished the seed by now and been able to take a break and acquire a drink. But the seed had other plans for me. That's okay. The seed giveth, and the seed taketh away. Alright, I've already been down there again. Alright, I really need to just find an exit. Any exit. I'm not picky. Because I am done randomly walking around in circles in the waterways. I'm gonna give it like one more once over, I guess, on the world map, just to see if there's anywhere else I could have forgotten. And if I don't get it, then I will find it with the debug menu. And it sucks. You know, I've completed many of these seeds. I was really hoping that the first one I complete during a stream would be, or the first seed I do during a stream would be a success, but this is a good opportunity to demonstrate humility and failure. Trying to think if there's anything I missed in any of the locations. I mean, there's that one gem that I didn't get in the House of Baffle. Unless there was something else. Like, I think there are normally four in the House of Baffle, but this is where I found the Underworld ticket. Because there's normally four here. I got the Underworld ticket, I got the three gems, and the one gem that I didn't get. So I don't think it's that. I don't think it's the Glacial Palace. I've been through Lakewood Dungeon so many times. All right, I tell you what. I will give the Arcadian the red orb. I know that all he has for me is a gem, and that's okay. I'm not expecting this to turn into anything, but maybe I'll have an epiphany while I'm walking around this area. I don't know. I definitely got this. there's not like an item up here that I missed, right? No. So he asked me to bring me the orb. He gives me a reward, and then he just tells me to keep the orb. These Arcadians, I swear. Who can fathom how their minds work? I sure can't. Sort of remembering some sort of secret in one of these lake areas where you can like walk through. Part of the earth, and there's something there, but I could be completely making that up. I know it's not this. I know I already did this. Yes, this is the one part of the waterways. I didn't really have access to the last time I was here. So maybe my hunch that I'm missing something in the waterways will bear fruit. No, I've been here. But if I'm remembering a section with amoebas, maybe it's near the other amoebas. I don't know. I'm grasping at straws now. Okay, this might be what I was remembering actually. Yeah, with the electricity. Yep. This is it. Is it the heart? It has to be, right? It totally is. And that's why I hate the waterways. I could have walked around for hours. Like, I don't know how you get to this part of the waterways other than going through that section under the lake. There must be a way, right? I don't know. But that is the sixth heart piece. Yeah, they do not call a lot of attention to the secret. It's very, very easy to forget about. But I did remember, you know, like I was halfway there. I was like, it's somewhere with amoebas and electricity. I know I'm forgetting something. I just didn't know how to get there. And because it's the waterways, there was just no way to get to the section from the other part of the waterways I was in. Okay. Let's go finish a damn video game. What do you say? How does that sound? Do you like finishing video games? I do. I don't do it that often, but when I do, I enjoy it. Oh, one sec. Hold on. Gotta reply to a message real quick. Okay. All right. Sorry about that. As I was saying, let us go finish a dang video game. Now that we have the sixth piece of heart, after much soul searching and many tribulations, we are finally ready to take on the Hollow King. Which, you know, at this point, there's no additional challenge, because I've finished this game numerous times, and the Hollow King is always the same. But, you know, I can't just leave it here, you know, now that I did the hard part. I can't just conclude. You know, I have to see it through to the end. Right. So, this bridge is here now. All six pieces of heart are lit up. This door's open. That's a good question. Why have I come so far? Oh. I'll just leave then. Hey, it's the wizard. Someone told me about that guy. You did hide them well. I hate you for it. Well, we'll just see about that. Alright, let's see how well I remember this whole section. Because it is sort of maze-like. And there are a few steps to it. But victory is definitely in grasp. In reach. In my grasp. I guess in my grasp would mean I already have it. And in reach means it is accessible. Alright, so I gotta come this way. No, I don't. Well, that's not the right way. Right, this is like a little secret bonus area with another Arcadian who has some sad stuff to say. None of this is necessary for completing my goal. And if for some reason you want to go back and revisit a previous area, there's a door to Subcon. But no reason to do that at this point. Oh. And, I mean, when I say no reason, I mean no mechanical reason. I mean, you can go back and, you know, talk to people. Say hi to your friends. Chill. Alright. I mean, I might have to go under lava for this part. In which case, all that running around was for nothing. I mean, there's a lot to this dungeon if you're going for 100%. Okay, I want to not hit the next checkpoint. because there's a lot of gems and stuff to collect. All right, I want to land on. No. I want to land on one of these platforms. There we go. Fill in this bridge. That should be adequate. Hi, Elizabeth Sargent. Welcome. Good of you to stop by. Good morning. The fishy is cute. I like the fishy. So now that we filled in this bridge, we can head over yonder. That checkpoint's okay. Avoid this gigantic RAM chip. So this is the shortcut back to the beginning of this dungeon. Okay. We want to not hit that checkpoint, if possible. Because as long as we don't hit that checkpoint, instead of walking all the way back around, we can just death warp. Makes it a heck of a lot easier. No music for this part. Huh. Makes it kind of spooky, I guess. I have to say, the Hollow King's strategy, not the most effective strategy I've ever seen. Or I don't know if that's the Hollow King, or if that's like an avatar of the Hollow King, or some sort of other skeleton monster that the wizard summoned. Famous last words. Oh, this is some good, proper creepy music. Oh, that's pretty good. I'm sad that I never listened to it before. It's a good track. So, one extra little dungeon here. With some banging tunes. I don't know if you could really call it a puzzle dungeon. There's not really much of a puzzle going on. You just have to touch each of these. I don't know what to call them. I mean hearts, but they're like an altar. Almost. A totem. And dodge these extremely dangerous enemies. They're just extremely threatening and scary. And again, this would be more interesting if you were going for 100%, but for me, the point of a randomizer is kind of to give you another goal besides 100%. Like, rather than doing everything, you're trying to get through the game doing as little as possible, or as little as you have to. So, doing that and also trying for 100%, I don't know, it seems a little redundant to me. Because, I mean, you basically have to visit every location anyway for the randomizer. So, you know, making sure you painstakingly get all the gems. I don't know. Like I said, just kind of redundant. But I mean, if a shiny is right there, I might as well grab it. Okay, I think that's... Was that all six? I don't think I missed any. Dot, dot, dot. Oh, hi, friend. Yeah, you're looking kind of pale. Yep, I punched the wizard in the face. I wonder if it's possible to make it here in a randomized seed without the Arcadian mark. Because, I mean, there might not be, you know, plot critical items behind the other doors. So is it possible to get here and just not be able to finish the game? That'd be kind of weird. Yeah, I suppose I am ready. That's true. Super Win the Game by J. Kyle Pittman. Key art by Kale Minges. This game is cute. I really enjoy it. Like, I've played it, like, it's not a long game, but I've played it, like, many more hours than one might expect. Just because I like going back to it, and I like doing the randomizer. Special thanks to Stephanie Meyer. I don't know if that's the Twilight author or a different Stephanie Meyer. Maybe the author just really likes Twilight? Or maybe he's friends with the Stephanie Meyer who wrote Twilight? Or maybe it's someone else with the same name? I don't know. So, once you get through the credits, you read the final book. And it takes you back to the tutorial. So, endless loop. You still have all of the same items. So, it's sort of a new game plus. If I collected all of the gems, then you can go to the jeweler and get the special trinket item, which fills in the last slot in my inventory there. It's like the amulet of the sleepless or something like that. But one final thing I'll show off. This isn't like part of the randomizer or anything, but after you finish the game, abracabam, you can go back to Hell World. And if you remember that place at the end with the mysterious note about the hiding spot, this is where the wizard is hiding now. But you can't get to him because you got the red and the blue orbs. So at first I thought that you would have to play through the entire game without getting those. But I mean, which is totally doable. I basically did just now. Like, I didn't find these until the very end. And I thought, oh, that's a neat challenge. You know, gives you an excuse to replay the game. But it turns out that this room back here seems legit. Okay, I'll hand over all my stuff. You can have that. And you can have that. Yeah, you're a really good thief. You just took all of my stuff. What will I do without all my precious stuff? So, now that you no longer have those items, it turns from a smile to a frown, and I'm gonna finally get my revenge on this wizard. Finally. I finished the game. I went through all of that. Cast a spell on me that will let me soar through the skies. No. Oh, that's it. You can't do anything else. Okay, well, I might as well. Yes, cast the soaring spell on me. It doesn't look like I'm soaring. Cast a smelly spell on me, completely by accident. Wizards do rule. And that's it. That's the big in-game secret. So now if I go back to town, oops, and talk to a fortune teller, oh, you're not the fortune teller, you're the fortune teller. 3 hours and 13 minutes, not a great time. I got really stuck on that last art piece. Died 115 times, not too bad. See, I almost got all the gems and I wasn't even trying. So, yeah, for randomizers, 100%ing the game with, you know, it kind of goes hand in hand. Hey, good morning, Adrian. Unfortunately, you are stopping in just as I'm finishing up, but I appreciate you saying hello. It's good to see you. I've never heard of that. I'm an unsung hero, that's true. I'm a clever rapscallion. And I smell a little funny. And this has been Super Win the Game. Randomizer. I was going to do another seed after this, but I wasn't expecting that seed to take quite so long, but I had fun, and I would do this again sometime. Let me know if you want to participate in some sort of race where we play the same seed and try to see who can finish fastest. That might be fun. This game is available, like, if you go to the author's website, like superwinthegame.com, it's like incredibly cheap right now. It's like $2. But also, if you bought the itch.io bundle for racial justice a few months ago, this game is in that bundle. So if you bought that, you already own it. So if this seems appealing, then I highly recommend checking it out. The vanilla game is fun too. You don't have to do the randomizer. And the prequel to this game, which I've also streamed before, you have to win the game. Also a lot of fun. So, yeah, this has been Super Win the Game. Thanks everyone for watching. Sorry for the technical difficulties and you know, streaming issues, you know, YouTube being YouTube and not working intuitively. Yeah, that will about do it. So thanks everyone for watching, and I will see you soon. Goodbye.